So Cate Blanchett, great to have you on the show and welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So in Tár, you speak German. So wie gut ist Ihr Deutsch?
It's not so good.
Wie geht es Ihnen?
Yeah, I learned it phonetically. I mean, I learned it at high school, actually. But being Australian, you don't get to practice it very much. Although there is quite a large German community in Handorf in South Australia.
But would be able to say something in German.
Well, eine kleine Kaffeebohne reiste nach Amerika. Amerika war abgeschlossen und der Schlüssel abgebrochen. Yeah, that's about as far as it goes.
That's wonderful.
But I did. It was interesting learning it because I learned it specifically playing an American who was the principal conductor of a major unnamed German orchestra. Yeah. I thought it was there was no German at all in the screenplay originally, and I said to Todd Field that I felt it would be. It would lack veracity if I didn't speak to the orchestra in German. So I worked with a wonderful woman, Franziska Roth, who teaches non-German speaking opera singers to sing Wagner.
It's more like a sound. It's not really teaching the words. I was wondering because in for example in a Lord of the Rings you speak in the Elvish language.
Yes, so which I've also forgotten.
Which one was easier to learn?
Actually, the German, because it had Elvish is such a mishmash of languages, as all languages are. But conducting is a form of communication, yes. And so you watch a lot of conductors speak to the orchestra and say they're conducting in Japan or in a country outside of their own culture. Is often they communicate with sounds, sort of a bit of they'll make noises. So it was a bit like an onomatopoeic exercise for me.
So did you learn for Tár as well how to conduct, and have you been really conducting, genuinely conducting the orchestra?
Well, we worked with the Dresden Philharmonie, and yes. What a generous bunch of musicians. They were extraordinary, and they had to act, and I had to conduct, because all of the music is diegetic, so all of the music you hear is made by the orchestra and by Nina Hoss and myself, and of course my character is also composing throughout, so Hilde Grundotier did the score. Yeah. So it's all made, so it was important that that I had that rapport with the orchestra. And it's, of course they don't play the concert music in performance, it's a rehearsal film, it's a process film. Okay. So I was conducting them in pieces. But yes, so no, I would have conducting dreams but yes, we made the music together.
This kind of LP and the CD out. I mean, this is amazing.
That is probably one of the most surprising things that's ever happened to me. If you'd asked me, would I have been on Deutsche Grammophon?
You have been playing the piano as a child, I think.
What
role did music play in your
music
education?
And dance were huge in, and they still are in my life. Because theatre, in a way, which is my first love, it's a bastard form. It will steal and borrow from any art form to make a hybrid form. And so I think it's a very elastic medium, which I love. And so sometimes it involves singing or playing an instrument, which you'll pick up and put down. Sometimes you feel like you're more akin to a dancer than an actor. Mm-hmm. So it's I use all of those things all the time in theatre. And you never know where the point of connection is going to come for a role. But obviously it was through the music this time, and I was very grateful to have the opportunity to pick up the piano again.
I read a very sad story where the piano played a really important role between you and your father, because your father suffered a heart attack and he died, and you last saw him when you were playing a piano.
Yes, I only realized that a few months ago. He passed away when I was 10. He died of a heart attack. So, I mean, now that I am the age I am, it seems very young. He was 40. And he left for work. And I just waved goodbye to him. And I didn't want to go and kiss him goodbye because I was practicing the piano.
Right.
And I sort of stopped playing soon after that. And I just suddenly thought, oh, I wonder if that's why I stopped. I felt very guilty. I had a very guilt-ridden relationship to the instrument.
Because you couldn't say goodbye to your father properly?
Yeah, well, I didn't. I felt very selfish, and I'd been playing the music. But I don't know. I mean, all of these things get incorporated into who you ultimately become, the dysfunctional human being you become as
well,
an adult.
More functional as well,
say. You feed all that dysfunction into the roles, I guess.
When you were 10 years old, did you think that you would become an actor at this time of your life?
No.
What did you think you would like to be?
No, someone asked me what I was passionate about, and I used to go on bicycle rides as a child. I thought I was a detective and I was solving mysteries.
Oh, good.
And I lived by this beautiful river in Melbourne, in Australia, called the Yarra River. And I was very, very upset by the amount of plastic bags and plastic detritus that would end up down by the river. And you know, there were livestock down there and sheep, and you know, you'd see the fish getting caught up in all the. And so I said that I wanted to start, when I was about 12, I wanted to start a supermarket chain that eradicated plastic.
That was really before the time, no?
Well, that's because really? I found it very upsetting. So that's what I thought. I loved acting and I loved dancing and I loved music, but I never ever thought it would be something I'd do with my life.
So, but then again, because you said that the perception of women in acting has changed, and
yeah.
There was long the talk was that there is not enough movie roles for women at a certain age. Has this changed over the last couple of years, do you think? That the perspective of women as well,
yes,
and what they are playing and.
Yes, definitely. I mean, I think we haven't even processed Black Lives Matter and the Me Too movement, and they're already being used in a pejorative way. But the fact that that was incredibly recent history, when women collectively said enough is enough in our industry. And I think it is upon us, because we're a very public industry, to make those changes publicly. I mean, still in the classical music world, I mean, just recently, there's been the first female concertmaster appointed in the Berlin Philharmonic, that glorious orchestra's 141-year history.
Yes.
I mean, it's taken 141 years in that industry. It happens in all industries.
Yes.
But in the performing arts and in the cinematic arts, I think it's really important that we discuss those changes publicly and make those changes. And certainly in my career, it's changed enormously because of the women who've been in front of me, because of the Meryl Streeps, the Helen Mirrens, the Judi Dench's, all of those people, Frances McDormand's, you know, have made the path for me. And it's really, I feel, the responsibility to keep that path open for women who are coming up behind me.
Yeah, you have been, you know, in this play in Tár, you play a successful woman, and then she turns out to be, as you know, as bossy, being a successful woman like a successful man.
Mm.
And there was some criticism as well, because then she's accused of sexual harassment as well. And the criticism said that finally, you know, a woman arrives to this stage and then she just behaves like a man. And do you feel there is a point in the criticism as well?
Well, I mean, I think the film is very much about power.
Yes.
More than it is about gender. And I think if you had a man playing the role, we understand what that patriarchal power looks like. We've seen it in the classical music world, in most performing arts, and certainly in major CEO, you know, triangular structures around the world. It's still very much there. But having a woman at the centre, it's still a fairy tale in a way. So we can look at the systemic abuses of power in a way that we couldn't if a man had been in that role. And I think it speaks to that level of criticism, which is, you know, people are entitled to their opinion. But I think the film is very ambiguous. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a bit like a Rorschach test as to what you think has transpired or not. And so people's reading of the film, I'm fascinated by, because I think it speaks to their own experience and the changes that they'd like to see. And I don't think that women's experience is monolithic. And I think that we oftentimes expect women to be heroic, self-sacrificing, graceful.
Better kind, you know.
Yes, but women,
mankind.
We're human beings. Mm-hmm. And so we are flawed and we do dubious things. Mm-hmm. And I think that as women, it's really important that we are allowed to fail, that we are allowed to be flawed, like every other human being on the planet.
I would like to stay on the topic of women in the business for just a minute before we go on to, for example, the role of art in war times. You have been among those who have spoken out against sexism quite early already in the beginning of your career. Do you think the things have changed after the whole Me Too debate? Is there more respect now towards women?
Well, I think that there was,
when I
entered the industry, I think there was a sense that there, and it was true, there was a finite amount of space for women to lead a narrative, to drive a narrative, to have an impact on the industry, to produce, to be, you know, be paid equally, equal pay for equal work. And so women were, through the media and were treated as competitors, mm-hmm. and in a way that we were siloed from each other. So our power, our collective power, was diminished.
Okay.
And I think that has definitely changed. I mean, if you look at, still when I walk on film sets, there are not nearly enough women behind the camera, in the set department, in carpenters, in the electrics. They're still very male dominated from a crew perspective, gentlemen.
Well, we have a lady on the camera.
It's
there.
Nice, but it's rare. Mm-hmm. It is rare that
sometimes we have a lot and sometimes not enough. Yeah.
Well, and look, and that will change. Yeah. And I look forward to the day when it's not remarked upon, when we're not having this conversation.
We're not talking about gender.
No, but unfortunately, it is for certain pockets of society, and they are a minority. They politicize these things very quickly. Mm-hmm. But when women's bodily autonomy is being challenged now in this century, right. in so many pockets of the world, it is important to keep one's, you know, the gender conversation, the race conversation.
Yes.
The cultural conversation front and center.
I would like to talk about the meaning of art in times of war, and I would like to show you a piece of a speech that President Zelensky delivered to the opening ceremony of the Berlinale. So let's take a small look at that.
Can art be outside of politics? Should cinema be out of politics? This is an internal question, but today it is, again, extremely relevant. Under such circumstances and at such times, art cannot be neutral, cannot be out. Cinema cannot change the world, but it can influence and inspire people.
So he says art cannot be out, cinema cannot change the world, but it can influence. What do you think about that?
For me, what is really important about gathering in the cinema, about gathering in a music concert, about gathering in a performing arts venue together, is that we do it collectively. And we find together whatever it is that we're watching, whatever it is we're listening to, we are united by, you know, we find what unites us. And I think we're living in a time, particularly when we're drawing national lines,
right.
there's a massive, enormous and ever-growing human displacement crisis.
Yes.
And I'm not a religious person, but we're not saying there, but for the grace of God, go I. You know, that could be me, that could be my brother, that, you know, we're looking at climate disasters that are happening, yet another earthquake in Syria. Mm. And that those earthquakes may be happening far from out where we're sitting right now, but it is happening collectively to us as a species. So I think that what we do when we gather together, when our politics and all of our personal concerns are set aside for one moment and we're joined, we're united through an experience, an event, I think that that is a very powerful reminder about what unites us.
Than nowadays. Germany has taken 1 million refugees from Ukraine the last year, and I know that you are engaged in the UN refugee aid, and you have been visiting camps all over the world. Do you understand people who say we cannot take all, we cannot help them all, because they are afraid, you know, that there would be too many, maybe strangers in their country?
I think what has been so extraordinary about Germany and Turkey, and of course, you know, the bulk of displaced people around the world are being offered shelter by neighboring countries and by the global south and countries that can ill afford to take those people in. The generosity that those countries have shown, and Germany is one of those countries, the burden has not been shared by other countries, and I think that is the problem.
Okay.
Is that it is a global problem. We talk about an outpouring of support for people in Ukraine and for incursions around the world, but yet when it comes to actually welcoming those people in, people have been forced to flee their homes through no fault of their own. I mean, I'm a mother of four children,
yes.
And so when I see through climate disaster or through conflict that children are being separated from their from their parents, from their siblings, you know, my heart goes out to them. And so, you know, it's of course it's about our countries, you know, burden sharing in the way that Germany has been so supportive of. But it's also on a very small level, you know, combating the xenophobic language that we hear all around us. We can all do these individual things, you know, supporting the organisations where we can to do the work that the, you know, the life-saving work that they do, because it's, you know, particularly in cold weather.
I want to get back to the movie, and I wanted to ask you, because you have been showered with awards already for the last role for Tár, and now you're nominated for an Oscar. Mm-hmm. And it would be your third one. And I think there was just Meryl Streep, Ingrid Bergman, Frances McDormand, who had three, and Katharine Hepburn had four. So what would that mean to you if this would really happen?
I don't even know how to answer that that question. You know, it's it always feels in a time where I feel the collective efforts of women and are being awarded. It's sort of there are so many extraordinary performances by women, and I sincerely mean it when I say that. To be in dialogue or in the same sentence as those is meaningful enough. And often in art, which is different to a sporting event, is it's so subjective in the end. And somehow, simply being nominated, you suddenly, overnight, you become a loser, you know, rather than a winner. So I feel it's a very provocative and, I think, rewarding film. And so the fact that it's even in that mainstream conversation and recognised by the Academy, who I so revere, I mean, that is an award in and of itself.
A film I can recommend to the audience, Tár. Thank you so much, Cate Blanchett, for having the time to meet today.
Thank you so much. Thanks for making time. Thank you.